Wherever you've been or what you've gone through, the Father is waiting for you. Let's begin a new family. You're welcome at Alva's house.
Welcome to Ron Phillips from Alva's House. I'm Angie McGregor.
I'm Pastor Ron Phillips, and we're going to talk about living in the sunshine.
On today's broadcast, Pastor Ron is going to give you 10 principles to have a life that matters. And Pastor Ron, I believe that a lot of people feel like their life doesn't count. It doesn't matter very much.
Right, and they don't know how to live. We're going to be going through 2 messages today and next week, one by me and one by my son, from the wonderful little book of Ecclesiastes. And as a matter of fact, we have 13 messages, but you're only going to hear 2 of them on television. This is a book that has the theme, Living Under the Sun.
Yeah.
And it's Solomon's way of talking about life on earth. See, you can be so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. Mm-hmm. We need to know how to put our feet on the pavement every day and live. And the book of Ecclesiastes tells us how. And in this opening message where I talk about a life that matters, we will give you 10 clear principles that will help transform your life. It'll make a difference. It'll help you to stop grinding up over little things, how to focus on the things that really matter, and how to allow God and the Holy Spirit to push you along, to get you up, to motivate you to live in light of the sunshine. Now, the clear thing about these messages you need to know is that I was coming out of the darkest period of my life, recovering from open heart surgery, when my son and I delivered this teaching. You are going to be powerfully blessed. Stay tuned. Ecclesiastes 7:11 says, "Wisdom is good with an inheritance and profitable to those who see the sun. For wisdom is a defense as money is a defense. But the excellence of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to those who have it." And then Ecclesiastes 8:4 only, "Where the word of a king is, there is power. And who may say to him, what are you doing?" You may be seated. We've been looking at the book of Ecclesiastes. The name Ecclesiastes means words to the gathering. Words to the gathering. It comes from Solomon, a man who had a lot of wisdom but didn't live it out. And so in his sad old age, he's writing Ecclesiastes. And the most used phrase in the book of Ecclesiastes is "under the sun." But if you stay out in the sun too long, you'll get sunburned. And may even get cancer. And Solomon lived all his life for what was down here without a thought to what was there until he was about to die. And then when he was about to die, he wanted to write to those who are younger and tell them, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Before the evil days come. He called old age evil days. I think we ought to reverse that, don't you? If all you live for is down here, it may be miserable days for you. But I want you to know I've got a destiny beyond the shores of this earth. So my spirit is still 16 years old. I look in the mirror and I can't believe what I see. Who is that old man looking back at me? Because I don't feel that way on the inside. And I am telling you, I believe that even when the years roll on, that we can learn from this man how life can matter and how it can be better. Now, this is one of those messages that is so practical and down to earth, you need to get a pencil out and write down the 10 things I'm going to tell you. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on them because I think it's important for you to see the whole that he's saying. Now, what is the key to Ecclesiastes 7 and 8? It's one word, better. Look at your neighbor and say, better. Say, life can be better. One of the important things to know when you're studying Scripture is that when a word is repeated over and over and over again, he's trying to tell you something. And 8 times in these 2 short chapters, we find that word better. I wish I could have found a decent translation of Ecclesiastes. I guess I'm going to have to write it myself. There isn't one. But I'm going to speak some of these verses. I'm going to tell you 10 keys to a life that's better and to a life that matters. And I think when you see them, they're so simple. If you'll apply them to your life, you're going to be able to make a difference in somebody else's life. And I want to tell you that you'll get along better on your job. You'll do better in school if you're a student. You'll have sense enough to know when to act, how to make choices. And you'll also see what's messing you up. And you may not like that part of the message. How many are ready to go? We're going to move quick. Number one, character counts. Look at Ecclesiastes 7:1. A good name is better. Just kind of read through these chapters when you get home and underline the word. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. A good name. Name in the Bible represents character. I want to tell you, if it kills you, do the right thing. Tell the truth. Keep your hands out of other people's pockets. Do your business with honesty and integrity. Don't cheat in school. Live your life so that it's transparent. A few days ago, the media staff brought me a telegram, and I don't believe in personal self-aggrandizement, and I'm not trying to do that, but it blessed me. The new Warfare Bible will be out in a few weeks. And they had quoted me on this huge poster about the value of it. And Mr. Strang, the president of that company, who, by the way, may be here with us next week, he said, when we talk about Ron Phillips and his study of the Scripture, we talk about integrity and truth. I'd rather have that than $1 million. Now, I'd take the million, but I'd rather have that. Number two, every moment in your life is precious. That's why he speaks about death, the day of one's death than one's birth. Better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for that is the end of all men. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by a sad countenance the heart is made better. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. Here's what he's trying to say. It'd be better to go to a funeral than to spend your time in a nightclub or a disco. He's not commending a sad life. You're missing the whole point. Here's what he says. You can go to all the entertainment you want to, but you're still going to die. And maybe if you think about that, you'll realize that the fact that you live on this planet, the third planet from the sun, that is the only planet we know anything about that has life on it, and you didn't have to get up and buy oxygen to breathe this morning or water to drink, that the fact that you're alive is a miracle, and that every moment that you're here is a precious, wonderful time, that you can love family and know God. And your life count for some purpose and matter for some purpose bigger than you are. Don't waste your life. I wish I could talk about the word fool, but that's a later message. I'll tell you what it is in Hebrew. It's cackle. Anybody ever heard of cackling? You know, that's an old southern word for laughing like a fool. Come from the Hebrew to cackle. Isn't that awful to be a fool? To live your life as a fool, someone who just laughs away their time, and when life's over, they've accomplished nothing. Number three, let me quickly say, learn to receive correction. I will tell you the reason many of you have never achieved what God wanted you to do. When someone tried to correct you before it got out of their mouth, you were already thinking of what you were going to say. and you've refused to submit to authority, to mentorship, you know it all, and nobody can say anything to you. Listen to what the Bible says, Ecclesiastes 7:5. It is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. And all I can think of is, with all the wisdom and mentorship, we got a generation walking around with earphones in, listening to the song of a fool all the time. You can't even talk to anybody. Oh, what'd you say? The word hear is the word to listen to. To some, everything is a joke. And they haven't embraced the seriousness. He says in verse 6, their laughter is like the crackling of thorns under a pot. So is the laughter of a fool. Surely, look at verse 7, oppression destroys a wise man's reason, and a bribe debases the heart. You know what he's saying? The stupidity and refusal to listen to authority and receive correction and instruction and to learn brings on a demonic, a control, a satanic control of one's life. Learn to receive correction. Number 4, slow down. Look at Ecclesiastes 7:8. The end of a thing is better than its beginning. There's that word better. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. You know, this has been a problem I've had. And I think with younger folk, it happens, and with older folk. We get an idea and we rush toward it before we're ready to get there, before we're ready to do it. And he said, wait a minute. Think about how this is going to end before you start. Oh, where there's no vision, the people perish. Let's get after it. Yes, but Jesus said, nobody builds a house until they sit down and count the cost. Isn't that good? And so he says, be patient. That means we have to learn to wait. And waiting is not laziness. It's getting God's season or timing for something. Can I tell you, can I confess, can I be human with you a moment? The mistake I've made is not the wrong vision. It's been trying to rush the vision. How many of you have noticed with your high-def TV, if they're broadcasting an analog and you're watching in high-def, the lips out of sync? That's what I think happens. We get just a half a step out of sync. We think God needs our help. We think he's got the timing wrong. We're like Abraham. We'll go to the Hagar's tent and we end up with an Ishmael, and we've got a Middle East crisis today 3,000 years later because Abraham went to the wrong tent one night because he thought God needed some help. Let me hurry while I'm trying to be patient. Do not be trapped by the past. Number 5. Look at verse 10. Why were the former days better than these? There's that word better. For you do not inquire wisely concerning this. Oh, I just wish for the good old days. You can have them. I remember when I started out pastoring, no air conditioning in the building, windows open. I remember one night I was preaching in Texasville, Alabama. A bug as big as my thumb flew in the window right down my throat. Got caught there. I had a choice. Cough or swallow. I just swallowed. That thing fluttered all the way down and it gave up the ghost. The first thing that I pastored a church at 19, the first thing we did, the piano wouldn't play. It was falling apart, but bless God, we bought air conditioning. My idea of camping out is the Hyatt Regency. I won't want to go back. I like driving that Escalade I've got out there. I had it cleaned inside and out this week, just drove it around a while just to think about it. I thought about that old Cutlass I used to drive, that old 75 Toyota. And then I thought, I'm driving a Cadillac, glory to God. If that makes you upset, I'm sorry. I don't want to go back the old days. I mean, thank God, let's bring the good stuff forward, but there's some stuff I don't want to bring forward. Amen? Hallelujah. I'm glad I didn't have to go to Dr. Sawbones when I did open heart surgery in the back of a room somewhere. I'm glad we had a hospital to go to. How many of you are glad for the miracles that we have around us here in America? And yes. Don't be trapped by the past. Number six, don't be an educated fool. Listen to this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance and profitable to those who see the sun. For wisdom is a defense, as money is a defense, but the excellence of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to those who have it. He contrasts knowledge and wisdom. Now get this. Knowledge, you went to Harvard. You were a smart man, but you became a recluse, and so you blew up a court building, and your name was Timothy McVeigh. And young people, when you get to college, the reason they have a sophomore year is because sophomore means wise moron. Because after you've been there a year, you think you're smarter than your parents. You try to go liberal. We've done this before. We've all been there. You think you're smarter than everybody else. And then you get embarrassed if you're out of a church here where we speak in tongues, jump, shout, lay hands on the sick, people fall out. You get embarrassed because you think it's all up here. And it's good that you're learning you can think and study. Nothing wrong with that. But you can get all the knowledge you want to, but if you don't have the wisdom of God on your life, you're just an educated idiot. That's all you are. And I know about education. I went 4 years to college and 4 years to graduate school. I earned a doctor's degree that is accredited by the Southern Association of Colleges and Universities. It wasn't a DD. I didn't do it. It was a real degree that I earned. So I'm not putting education down. But education is no substitute for wisdom. Now, what is wisdom? Knowledge is what you're able to learn. Wisdom is to put what you've learned into practice. And that's the difference. You know, don't be so smart that you don't have any common sense. And what good is what you know if you can't help somebody with it? If you can't get a job with it? Wisdom is good with an inheritance. So you can leave a lot of stuff to your kids, but if they're stupid, they will waste it. Unless you got wisdom, which is wisdom in the Bible is not knowledge, it's being able to put steps of action to what you're doing. It's being able to formulate a plan to get from A to Z. I'm getting blunt. Wisdom gives life to knowledge. Knowledge is dead unless it can be translated into life. So don't be an educated idiot. After my surgery, I ran into a feller who described to me in great detail all about open heart surgery. So I asked him, "Are you a surgeon?" "No," he said. I said, "What do you do?" He said, "I'm manager of a store." I don't care how much he knows. Dr. Richard Morrison operated on me because he knows how to do it. So you can go on the internet and learn how to do open heart surgery, but you ain't cutting on me. And by the way, I don't want to be your first try either. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? The only time I got nervous was after surgery when my nurse told me, he said, "Well, you know, Dr. Morrison had you stitched you up himself." I wanted to say, "Who would have done it if he hadn't have done it?" I wanted to ask, but I didn't. "You want to see my scar?" "No." I got to hurry. I'm out of time. Quickly, live a balanced life. Look at verse 16. "Do not be overly righteous, nor be overly wise." Why should you destroy yourself? "Do not be overly wicked, nor be foolish." You know what he's saying? Don't act too spiritual because you're not. Good. Live a balanced life. Number eight. Quit getting your feelings hurt. Look at verse 21. Would everyone please listen to this in the church? I was at the grocery store the other day, and this lady was so mad because somebody had parked where she, in her handicapped place. And I just looked at her and said, if I was you, I wouldn't come back here. I mean, after all, they ought to know better than that. Now, you'll go back to the same grocery store, the same mall, the same theater, but if it happens at church... Listen to verse 21. Do not take to heart everything people say, lest you hear your servant cursing you. For many times also your own heart is known that you have cursed others. There have been times in your heart you said, I don't care you. Don't get your feelings hurt. This is too long. Give others wings, number 9, and not restrictions. Verse 26, I find more bitter than death a woman whose heart is snares and nets, whose hands are fetters. He who pleases God shall escape from her, but the sinner shall be trapped by her. Now, it could be a man or a woman, okay? And here's what this means. If your relationships are not making you better, you're tied to the wrong person. If your relationships are crushing your dream, if who you're going with, young people, isn't compatible with what God has told you to do, then you become trapped. No matter how good that person may be or how good you may be, you can come trapped. Because let me tell you about relationships don't operate in fear. They operate in faith. And if you love somebody, you give them wings to become everything they could be. Y'all listen to this? My nephew. You want that other person to become the best person they could possibly be. Give others wings and not restrictions. Finally, realize that you'll never have all the answers. How many of you know you don't need an answer, you just need God? You don't need to know what's going on, you need to know who is running things. That's why he says in Ecclesiastes 8:4, where the word of a king is, there's power. And guess who the king is? Not Solomon. The king is God. He's the king. And his word has power. He spoke, the creation came into being. He spoke, and water turned to wine. He spoke, and Lazarus came out of a grave. He spoke, and crippled people got up. He spoke, and something happened to most of you in this room. And your life has never been the same.
And his word can break through the clouds in your life. Are you ready to live in the sunshine? I know you may be discouraged today, but Pastor Ron, we need to pray for those folks that God will break through.
He's going to break through right now. I was in intensive care. My nurse came and sat down and said, I worked two shifts because I wanted to take care of you because... Before my dad died, watching you on television, the Word of God changed his life. I was at the darkest moment of my life, but the Word of God came alive even in intensive care, and I saw the sunshine. I mean S-O-N, Jesus. And you can live here on this earth in spite of all of its difficulties, all of its problems. You can live a joyful life. Father, right now I pray for a mighty release of your Word on everyone who has been watching. Lord, let them make up their mind today to walk according to your truth and let this other junk go. Lord, may they get wings and not restrictions today. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, let me explain something to you. Not often do we give you a chance to study the Bible with us, but we have a series of 13 messages. Six by me, six by my son, and one by Pastor Rick White. These are powerful truths,
all the way through this book of Ecclesiastes, a book you've probably rarely looked at in your life, but a book full of wisdom on how to live under the sun. We can make this available to you at a cost. All the proceeds will go to get the gospel out. We also have our wonderful Bible available for you to open the truths of God's Word. We want you to be resourced to live in the sunshine and not let the clouds darken your day. So go to the phone right now and let us send these powerful teaching tools out to you now.
Although dark clouds may be overshadowing you now, it's good to know that the clouds are parting and sunshine is on the way. If the skies aren't bright in your life, we can help you learn to live in the sunshine. In this 13-part practical teaching from the book of Ecclesiastes, Pastor Ron Phillips and his son Ronnie Phillips Jr. will help you find a life beyond the little stuff, a life with no regrets, and a life that matters. You'll also discover what to do when everything is not enough. And Pastor Ron's good friend, Rick White, will show you how to have a life that's been changed by grace. Call now to order your copy of the complete series, Living in the Sunshine, on CD or USB thumb drive, 1-800-877-6493, or order online at ronphillips.org. You can also send a check or money order for $70 to Ron Phillips, P.O. Box 937, Hickson, Tennessee, 37343. The big event is even bigger. This year, Pastor Ron welcomes Jensen Franklin, Randy Caldwell, Tommy Bates, and Perry Stone for the big event, August 21st through 25th at Abba's House in Chattanooga. Come meet Pastor Ron and Paulette Phillips in person and experience the ministry of some of the most anointed men and women of our day. It'll be the biggest event of the summer. The big event at Abba's House, August 21st through 25th. Free registration at ronphillips.org.
I know you're excited about freedom. And that's the reason we have prepared the Ron Phillips Ministry Spiritual Warfare Study Bible for you. There's never been a Bible like this, beautifully bound. All the normal Bible study helps, concordances, and so forth are here. But we have 21 profiles of biblical warriors, 33 prayers that you can pray to set you free, 23 interactive study elements, 68 special studies are in here. There are six appendices in here that list the 37 curses, has the groups of demonic entities you fight, and gives you the 60 symptoms of demonic operation. This is a powerful tool to help you walk in freedom. When you add it to the 40 chapters of the award-winning book, Everyone's Guide to Demons and Spiritual Warfare, you are fully equipped to engage the enemy and walk in freedom. You call now, and they'll tell you how you can have this powerful set of tools. Call now.
Abba's House is a place of forgiveness, healing, and hope. That's why Pastor Phillips would like to hear from you and invites you to join us in partnership to take this media ministry to the nations of the world. So call the number on your screen to discover how you can become a partner with Ron Phillips Ministries today. And check out our website at ronphillips.org. So join us again next week. You're always welcome at Abba's House.
Welcome.